But this year, because Rent was starting, he'd been working so many years on it, because it was so important, it was a big moment in his life, he actually wanted it to be for us, those of us who were working on the show. And also because he wanted us to become his friends. He wanted us to be in his life, and not just as co-workers. And all of that was a very unusual and special gesture on his part from any writer that I'd ever worked with. And then he shared with us again as a group about his friends that he wrote it for, and that the show was his attempt to honor them, and that we were in some ways bringing his friends to life, and he wanted to thank us for that. So that was all very, very, very special and meaningful. And then on the next day, there were only three of us who continued on from the 94 workshop into this new production. Myself, Daphne Urbandega, who was the original Mimi, and Gilles Chiasson, who was the original Will I soloist, Will I Lose My Dignity, and the Squeaky Man, for those interested in that. So we were like in rehearsal day one, and like we all had this little secret, like, you know, Christmas, we knew what was in the wrapping paper before everybody else found out. And Michael started us out that day the same way we started out the year before, by starting the day with learning Seasons of Love. And it was just an even better group of people. The voices were that much stronger, the blend was that much better. And Jonathan had done tremendous work on the rewriting, as evidenced by the lyrics that I shared with you earlier, and many other things. So just the show had taken this giant leap forward. He'd worked really hard to make it better. And it was really good back then, but it was even better. So again, we're working, I keep telling people, I remember telling people too, you should get your tickets for me now because I think you might have trouble later. Who was right? Didn't know quite the scale that it was going to be. So everything is going along really well. The only thing that wasn't written on day one of rehearsal, there's a place in the script where instead of a song or a scene, it said insert boffo number here for Maureen and Joanne. He had been really struggling to write something for them, and he hadn't come up with anything that worked. Until like the second or third week of rehearsal, he literally ran through the doors brandishing his music and sat down at the piano and started banging out Take Me or Leave Me. And then gave it to Dina and Mandel and Freddie Walker, who then proceeded to literally tear the roof off the theater and everything. So that was like where he was in the peak of his power. So in about our third or fourth week of rehearsal, we were rehearsing in this really wonderful rehearsal room that was next door to the theater, but then this particular day we were on stage mapping a little bit of staging out on the stage. And it was Adam, Pascal, and myself, and we were working on What You Own. And we were literally singing the lyrics, "We're dying in America, give them a million," when there was this commotion in the back of the theater. And our production manager rushed to the stage. He's like, "Nothing to worry about, but Jonathan just fainted. But we're gonna take him to the hospital. He's up now, but it's probably nothing." And we were like, "That's really weird. But he seemed like a little pale, but we thought, well, he's exhausted and everything that's happening is really exciting, but certainly wouldn't, certainly didn't think it was anything more than that." So we got word that he had been examined, and they sent him home thinking maybe it was like, food poisoning or something. And that he should probably stay home and just rest, because at the point where we were in the process, he wasn't like doing a lot of active rewriting at that moment. We were working, getting all the technical things together. And then the way the process goes, you get all the technical things together, then you start doing the previews in front of a live audience, and then as a writer, you get a lot of really good clues on what's working, what isn't working in front of a live audience, and then you go do your rewrite. So it would be a good time for him anyway to take a step back, rest, recuperate, and then come back fresh. So we got word a couple days later that he'd still not been feeling that great, but that he went to another hospital and again was sent home. This time, maybe they thought maybe it was the flu, something like that. So, that was all, no one was, that concerned about it. But we were really happy the night of the dress rehearsal that he was well enough to be there. And he was still looking a little pale, but he was very, very excited. And to say that the dress rehearsal went well would be very much an understatement. Dress rehearsals, they're in New York anyway, I don't know if they do this here with the shows that you guys put on, but they're invited, so it's open to an invited audience of like friends and colleagues and family and stuff like that. So it was packed, and that doesn't necessarily mean, however, that they're always going to be like jumping for joy. I mean, they're going to be supportive, but they're going to be honest, especially in New York. They're, you know, they're fellow artists, so they're not going to just, you know, be like cheerleaders. So, but it went really, really well. They literally jumped to their feet at the end of the night. There was this incredible like wave of response coming back at us from this dress rehearsal. And afterwards, after I came out from backstage, I wanted to like go over to Jonathan and give him a hug. But he was surrounded by people. And usually if you go to see a show, if people wait afterwards, they want to talk to the actors because they're the ones they recognize. But it was clear that they weren't just his friends that were waiting to talk to him. That there were people who were sort of just like gravitating toward him. That they wanted to talk to him, meet him, thank him. Including I found my agent who had been there, and she's like, she said that she had gone up to him at an intermission. And she was so blown away by what she'd seen. So I'm waiting to talk to him, and I'm very excited about it. You know, there's a lot of stuff that I'd sort of been saving up to tell him that night, because I kind of get that way. I like to take occasions and sit someone down and sort of like blast at them like a bunch of stuff. The stuff I wanted to tell him was just how grateful I was for everything he'd done for me, including writing the show in the first place, including giving me a chance to sing on stage again, and writing a show that was saying such important things, and also for being my friend. I mean, I just wanted to kind of like pour all that out. But he was surrounded by those people, and then I was talking to some people, and then when I looked back, he was gone. I was like, "Ooh, where is he?" And I found out that he was talking to a reporter from the New York Times, who was so blown away that he asked Jonathan to sit for an on-the-spot interview. And it was weird to have a reporter at the dress rehearsal, except for that he was just there because it was the 100th anniversary of La Boheme, and he thought, "Well, that's interesting. They're doing this rock opera version of La Boheme, so I should go report on this." And he was a classical music writer, but he was so. Literally, those were the words that he used to describe it, apparently, that he was so impressed that he wanted to sit right then and there and talk to Jonathan. Now, you may or may not know this, but the New York Times is a somewhat influential paper. And for an artist like Jonathan, for better or for worse, they can literally make or break a career. And for someone like Jonathan, who at this time was 35 years old, who had been struggling to get his work out there in the world, he'd had readings, and he'd had agents, and he'd had interest, and he'd had like small little things here and there, but nobody giving him the big thumbs up, nobody giving, you know, the big rubber stamp and the go for it, here's your production. He's on the verge of this happening now with Rent off Broadway, and then at the same time, this writer from the New York Times sits him down for an on-the-spot interview. I'd say that things were looking up for him. That's an understatement. So I wanted to kind of see, I thought maybe I could wait around to talk to him, but I really had all that stuff I wanted to say. But then the interview just sort of went on, and I was like, well, that's as it should be. You should talk to him as long as you should talk to him. And so I watched, they were sitting in the box office, which was essentially the only private, quiet place in the small New York Theater Workshop theater. And I watched them through the window for a few minutes, and then I said, and I thought about even knocking on the glass so I could at least wave goodnight to Jonathan, but I was like, I'll see him tomorrow. So that, you know, that night I went home, still kind of flying high from this incredible response that we'd gotten for the dress rehearsal. And the next morning, a phrase that you will almost never hear me say, I woke up before my alarm went off, because that never happened. Because I was so excited still from, you know, I still had all that adrenaline. And on my phone was a message from the theater's artistic director asking me to call him right away, which was kind of strange. And he sounded sort of grim. I was like, uh-oh, did someone get fired? Or is the show canceled or postponed? Or is it something weird? But before I could call him back, the phone rang. It was my agent, Sarah, who had been there the night before. And that she worked with Jonathan's agent. And that he had gotten the call that Jonathan had gone home after the dress rehearsal and collapsed on his kitchen floor and died. And as I mentioned, he was 35, and he hadn't been feeling well, but there was zero indication that he was close to dying would be an understatement. There was no indication that he was going to die. It was crazy. And, you know, it was like, well, what does this mean for the show? And she said, well, no one knows for sure, but I think it will continue. So then I called the theater, and I'm like, well, we're all going to gather at the theater crying or not crying. We all just sort of were like sitting together for a very long time. And sometimes people would say some things, sometimes they wouldn't. But then at a certain point in the day, Michael Greif, the director, came up to me and was like, I think I wanted to talk to you about what we think we're going to do tonight, which is we want to cancel the preview, and then, but we should do something, so we want to perform the show for his friends and family. But, because his parents were flying in from Albuquerque, where they lived at the time. And, but he said, but we don't want it to be about the technical issues, so let's just have you all sit at the tables and sing through the score, have it be about the words and music. And that made a lot of sense. And once we had that to push forward to, that sense of purpose certainly helped all of us kind of put our energy into that. And did we, you know, of course there was no way to know how that was going to seem. It was going to seem weird to be performing on this day, but at the same time it felt absolutely right that we couldn't leave the theater silent. We had to fill it with his words and music. That seemed absolutely right. So several hours later, when his friends and family started coming to the theater, it was like this fresh wave of shock and grief coming at us. And I met his parents before the performance, who were, you know, seemed sort of completely dazed and very warm, but like lost themselves. And we sat up at the tables and sort of just dove in and started singing this incredible score. And among the many remarkable things about that night was the fact that, you know, the show is, there, it's not like a laugh riot, but there's some funny things in it, especially in the early few minutes of the show. There's like a phone call from Mrs. Cohen, Mark's mom. It's pretty funny. And, you know, and the woman who was inspired that character was sitting in the audience. And yet the audience really like laughed very warmly and fully at that stuff. And then Rent kicked off with this, you know, as our musical director liked to talk, he said it should feel almost like a hitting the audience in the head with a 2x4. It was like blasting out of the gate, and I can go like that. That happened at the end of it. There was this incredible cheer, like at a rock concert. So even in the face of all of this grief and dismay, the power and the joy, the peace was coming through. And I wouldn't have been able to articulate this that night, but looking back on it, it's, you know, the show itself, that's part of what the show is. The show is in and of itself. Is about a group of people coming together in the face of crisis and being able to find all of the joy and expression of their lives. Not denying the sadness, not putting it in a dark corner, including it, to say to people living with, not dying from